for you, what every smoker wants. Mildness plus no unpleasant aftertaste.
Chesterfield always takes the place. That milder, mild tobacco never leaves an aftertaste.
So, hey, open the pack and give them a smell, then you'll smoke them. Someone waits for me.
This is Ken Carpenter welcoming you to the Bing Crosby Show for Chesterfield. Produced and transcribed in Hollywood with John Scott Trotter, his orchestra, Judge Collins of the Bears, and Bing's guest, Miss Judy Garland. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we bring you a man who was recently fortunate enough to cash in on his Blue Cross hospital plan, Mr. Bing Crosby.
Oh, right.
Thank you, Dennis. Real pleasant to see that my operation hasn't upset you. You're positively jocose about the whole thing.
Well, I guess I really shouldn't be so flip.
No, this is quite a thing. Miss Howard, I give you about 45 minutes.
I know you could. Well, tell me about the big affair. Did you have a surgeon or did Senator Kefauver look into you?
Surgeon, Ken. I was under ether, not under oath.
Good.
Before I go any further, though, I want to thank all the folks who sent me such nice gifts while I was in the hospital.
Ah, plenty of loot, huh?
Oh, nearly topped Christmas. Can't even before the operation, John Scott Trotter brought me flowers, the Ridmares brought me candy, and my brother Everett brought me some papers to sign.
Well, that's Ev for you.
Not for me, that's Ev for Ev.
I'm glad you're up and around now. I certainly hope the operation didn't leave you with a scar.
Oh, what difference would it make if I have a scar?
Well, it makes a lot of difference.
Ah, no difference at all.
What does do? You're in show business.
Yes, but I'm not Lily St. Cyr, you know. I'm no ex-DGS.
I want to tell you something, Bing. Your operation was sensational.
Yeah?
It was positively the most thrilling thing I ever saw.
The most thrilling thing you ever saw?
Yes, didn't you know?
What?
It was on television.
On television?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's what those papers were that ever had me sign.
Believe me, Bing, it was great. What television needs is more shows like that.
Well, not for me.
I was wondering, Bing, has your operation affected your singing any?
No, I sing just as bad as ever. To illustrate, I prepared a little thing called Sparrow in the Treetop. In fact, I recorded this with the Andrews sisters. However, tonight the Ridmares will do the Andrews sisters' part. This is a quaint little thing. John Scott, will you quaint it up for me?
Sparrow in the treetop, sparrow in the treetop. Oh, he loves his mate. Sparrow in the treetop, sparrow in the treetop, scared of going home because it's too darn late.
Don't look at me, sweetheart, with scorn in your eyes. I've been out all night, I'm gonna tell you no lies. Stopped in one place, I heard him singing a song. Like a lonely sparrow, I started singing along. I just a singing in the tavern all night, sitting in the tavern, in the tavern,
singing my song.
Walked a blonde, and here she asked me to dance. I told that blonde,
no, no,
no, no, that there wasn't a chance.
That there wasn't a chance.
I love my kids, and my beautiful wife.
Is that the honest truth?
Well, I swear by my life, I kept a singing in the tavern all night, sitting in the tavern. forgive, 'cause I'm telling you true. I was in that tavern, only thinking of you.
Only thinking of you.
I was singing,
Bell in the tree.
All night, sitting in the tavern,
Bell in the tree.
I'm scared of going home because it's too darn late. Copeland out of Georgia and Kyle.
Well, I like it.
You do?
It was really great.
It's a little bizarre. Thank you anyhow, Kenneth.
Say, I meant to ask you before, Ben. You've traveled through the South, haven't you?
Oh, I love the land of the lasses and the corn pones. Why do you ask?
Well, you must have seen tobacco growing.
Yes,
and
I
maybe have. Even talked with fellows who raise it.
Oh, yes, but if you're using this devious means to lead us into the proof of Chesterfield's mildness, we have arrived, old man. We're here.
Right you are, Bing. And the proof is in this statement from Mr. Norman C. Cagle of Carthage, North Carolina. He tells us, I've been a tobacco grower for 32 years. To judge tobacco for its mild smoking qualities, I smell it. If it smells milder, I know it will smoke milder. If that tobacco is made into cigarettes, those cigarettes will smell milder and smoke milder. That's why I smoke Chesterfield.
Folks, that same statement was signed by over 1,000 prominent tobacco growers, and it proves that Chesterfields are milder. But now we'd like to offer you the proof that Chesterfields leave no unpleasant aftertaste.
It's from the country's first and only cigarette taste panel who reported, Chesterfield is the only cigarette in which members of the panel found no unpleasant aftertaste.
And that's the story, friends. Only Chesterfield gives you mildness plus no unpleasant aftertaste. So from now on, ABC. Always buy Chesterfield. Here's a new tune. I'm sure you've heard it on many of the radio programs lately. Rather nice one, I think. I hear that sentimental music when I'm holding you tight. I heard it from the moment you came into my sight. Sentimental music coming out of the night, saying you're the one. You're the one. Only when you're near I hear that sentimental music spinning round in my brain. Fills the night with echoes of my favorite strain. Just one look at you, there's that haunting refrain, saying you're the one for me. My darling, is it magic? All the music coming from above. Yes, it's magic. The magic of your love. I know that when we're close together, or if we're far apart, funny how that sentimental music will start. Sentimental music round and round in my heart, saying you're the one, you're the one. Darling, can't you see you've started sentimental music for me? Now that we've established the sentimental mood, let's welcome back one of my very favorite guests, Miss Judy Garland. Wonderful to see you, Judy. How are you?
I'm just fine. How's my favorite television star feeling?
I want this understood, Judy. I had no idea that my operation was being televised, honestly.
Well, look, the next time you're on television, let me give you a little tip.
What's that?
Don't just lay there. Do something.
Oh, why should I? Nobody else on television does. A very latent art.
Well, Ben, despite everything, you gave a magnificent performance.
Oh, now, what kind of a performance should I give? You just said I was laying there. I was unconscious.
Well, you know, you always have such an easy, relaxed way of working. Nobody knew the difference. Hey, you know, that was quite a scandal at the hospital, wasn't it?
Scandal? What's that?
You know, they arrested Bob Hope's brother in the corridor.
They did? For what?
He was trying to get their doctor to throw the operation.
Believe Bob would do a thing like that.
Of course not. He sent his brother to do it.
Whatever it was, I'm sure it was all a rib. Must have been a joke. Anyhow, Judy, what number are you going to sing for the folks tonight?
Well, I thought I might do mean to
you. That's one of my favorite oldies. Mr. Carter, will you take over right into here? Thrilling.
Thank you, Ben.
Just what our shindig needs, the feminine touch. Hey, have you noticed, Judy, by the way, that this has been a big year in show business for the fair sex?
Yeah, I have. The gals have been getting a lot of attention. Say, I'm as soon as a smash on television.
Mm-hmm. Lula Bankhead, she's just cooking up a storm in radio. Betty Davis and Gloria Swanson are battling it out for Motion picture honors. And
Judy Holliday's doing pretty good, too.
Yeah, Judy Garland ain't doing bad, either. I tell you, women have really, the women have really taken over in the entertainment field. It's fantastic.
You really think so?
Well, might as well face it. Men are on the way out.
Well, that raises a very important question for us women.
What's that?
Which way'd they go?
No kidding, Judy. If this current trend continues, the gals will have to take over radio. Pretty soon we'll be hearing programs like One Woman's Family. Phyllis Spitalny and her all-boy orchestra. Mrs. District Attorney. Wife's Other John. I don't know if it's going on and on.
Well, maybe women will move further into radio and even replace those red-blooded, hard-boiled He-Man characters like Sam Spade.
A girl Sam Spade? No, never.
Don't be too sure. I'll tell you what I mean.
I think we're slipping into a stretch. <here. laughs> There's every never indication done. Of a little stretch. All right.
My name is Sarah Spade, private investigator. License number 1697. In my business, my clients call me a special investigator, a private eye. A private eye who uses eyeshadow. It was late one night. I was in my San Francisco office, wondering how I ever got into this racket, when the door opened and he walked in. And I recognized him immediately. Rodney Lillis Crosby. Of the socially prominent San Francisco family. He had big blue eyes, like two pools of water, the kind that make you want to take off your shoes and go wading in them. Around town, he was known as quite a playboy. Although, according to his lady friends, he didn't play like a boy. Then he spoke.
I need some detective work done, and a party by the name of Spade was recommended to me.
That's me, Sarah Spade.
I must say, I'm amazed. A good-looking doll like you doing detective work. Have you pinched many guys?
It's about even.
Now then, maybe you can help me.
As Mr. Dreamboat sauntered past my desk, he exuded an exotic aroma that was intoxicating. One whiff and you didn't know whether you were coming or going. You didn't care as long as you were staying. I watched him as he sat in a chair, carefully crossed his legs. Then what happened was no accident. That pants leg had been trained to creep up just so far and reveal a garter, a black garter. The rest he left to your imagination.
I need your help. It's about my fiancée, Pamela Cooper. Miss Cooper has disappeared.
Uh-huh. The Cooper taker.
I discovered Pamela missing when I arrived at her home this morning. I'd been invited for our usual Sunday breakfast. Kipper.
Uh-huh. The Cooper Kipper taker.
First, I suspected she might have been kidnapped. Her father's a wealthy mining engineer. He made his money in copper.
Oh. The copper Cooper Kipper taker.
Now, there was no inkling of Pamela being in danger. Last night, she was so gay. We danced for hours at our favorite nightclub.
What nightclub?
I'd rather skip it.
But that's important. What nightclub?
The Copa Kappa.
Well, why skip it? It sounds fun.
Yeah.
The Copa Kappa, Kappa, Copa, Copa, Copa.
Miss Spade, you've just got to help me find Pamela.
Go with the scene to the Copa Kappa. It turned out to be a waterfront dive. I recognize the proprietor as a prominent hoodlum known as Sardine Saul. Hanging in a frame over the bar was the first dollar he ever made. He had to put it in a frame. He made it so bad he couldn't pass it. He walked to the bar and Rodney proceeded to question him about the disappearance of Pamela Cooper.
I'm looking for my fiancée, the young lady I was here with last night.
Yeah, what does she look like?
Well, she's a... It's a tall, willowy redhead with gorgeous hazel eyes, cute little dimples, sparkling white teeth, and a beautiful, shapely figure. If you find her, will you call me?
Call you? Are you kidding?
You've got to help me. Ever since Pamela's disappearance, I've been going mad. You hear me? Mad.
Now, don't be so upset, Rodney. Pamela's not the only pebble on the beach. You must remove her from your mind.
I've just had a pebble removed. No use. I'll never be able to forget Pamela. I shall never be able to forget Pamela. Pamela, my fiancée. Pamela, my sweetheart. Pamela, my loved one.
And I dress you lot. And let me take you in my arms. Like this.
Like this?
And snuggle up. Like this.
Like this?
And place my lips close to yours. Like this.
Hmm.
Now tell me. Tell me you'll try to forget Pamela.
Pamela? Who's Pamela?
You see, don't say to solve your problem already.
You know, Judy, seeing as how our little play had such a romantic ending, don't you think we could blend into something romantic musically?
Hmm? Well, sure. How about Irving Berlin's tune, You're Just in Love?
Great.
I hear singing and there's no one there. I smell blossoms and the trees are bare. All day long I seem to walk on air. I wonder why. I wonder why. I keep talking in my sleep at night. And what's more, I've blown my appetite. Stars that used to twinkle in the sky are twinkling in my eyes. I wonder why.
Good time to talk about money.
Money? Isn't that a rather touchy topic at tax time, Ken?
Oh, don't misunderstand me, Bing. I just want to remind our listeners that they get more for their money when they ABC always buy Chesterfield.
True, Ken. True indeed. And that's because Chesterfield is the only cigarette that gives you mildness plus no unpleasant aftertaste.
Oh, and so, speaking of taxes, Bing, they say the government now has you on a simple ABC payment plan.
What do you mean? What's that, Judy?
A, always need it. B, Bing's got it. C, come on, let's get it.
Now, that's a vast question, Judy. Not two. What were you saying, Ken?
The Chesterfields do give you more for your money. They give you mildness, plus no unpleasant aftertaste. And friends, you can prove that yourself. Just put your cigarette money down for a pack of Chesterfields. Then open it and get a whiff of that milder, delicate aroma. Like the tobacco growers tell you, tobaccos that smell milder, smoke milder.
Smoke Chesterfield, and you'll see how true that is. Chesterfields are milder, and what's more, they leave no unpleasant aftertaste.
Yes, that fact has been confirmed by the country's first and only cigarette taste panel. So next time you buy cigarettes, remember this.
Chesterfield has, for you, mildness plus no unpleasant aftertaste. And to help you remember those 2 points, the kids and I are going to set up the music right here.
Chesterfield always
takes
first place. That mild and mild
tobacco
never leaves an
aftertaste. Oh, ho, open the pack and give them a smell. Then you smoke them. Smoke them. Bobby Guy on the solo cornet, and that represents tonight's closer for this evening. I want to thank Judy Garland for joining us here.
Well, it was fun, Bill. Who's going to be with you next week?
Why don't you come back next week?
Hi, you talk me in.
Good. Judy, if you'll pardon me for a minute, I'd like to wish the Campfire Girls Incorporated a very happy birthday.
Mm-hmm.
A little early with this, because their birthday week doesn't begin until March 11th, but I didn't want to forget it. Good night, Judy.
Good night, Rodney.
Good night, Sarah. Good night, folks. See you next week for Chesterfield, the best cigarette for you to smoke.
The Bing Crosby Show, presented by Chesterfield, was produced and transcribed in Hollywood by Bill Morrow and Murdo MacKenzie. Tune in next week and hear Bing and his guest, Miss Judy Garland.
Fly back to Chesterfield and do it today. For the first time, you get the cigarette.